And today we're starting a brand new series called Anchor Ready. I don't know how good you are at navigating the unpredictable storms of life. I don't know if you've ever experienced mountaintops and valleys, highs and lows, sun and rain, healing and pain, joy and sadness. But the reality is, if you've been alive for more than a few years, you probably have had the opportunity to experience all of those dynamics. And so many people often get stuck in one of those dynamics. They get stuck in one of those places. And maybe there's a valley experience that they've had in their life, and it hurt them, it caused them so much pain and disappointment that that's framed their outlook on the future now, and convinced that they are people that deserve to live in that valley. Or maybe they constantly feel like they've missed out on something. And today I want to bring a word that over the next few weeks we're going to be looking at a number of areas that says that no matter what goes on around you, whether you're in a high point or a low point, joyous point or a sad point, that you can know a strength in your life and an anchor in your life that will hold you firm no matter what. And I don't know if you want to be that person. I'm sure you've got some of those people that you go to. I love those people, don't you? People that when you're in the middle of a crisis, you think, who do I phone? Who do I call? Who would be good at this time? And they're usually someone that has discovered an anchor in their life. And you know that they can handle your storm. Because sometimes when you transplant your storm onto someone else and got an anchor, they begin to wave around as well. It begins to affect them. And I believe God has called you and I to be people who are anchor ready, to be strong, that when the storms of life come, that you're not going to be tossed around by the moment, but that you're going to stand full of faith, full of boldness, and able to hold your place in life. Do you want to be that person? Yeah. God is looking for those people. I wonder who those will be in the room, and I believe it can and it should. It's your destiny. It should be you. We're going to look at some scriptures together. Hebrews 6, 19 says this. We have this hope as an anchor for the soul, firm and secure. It enters the inner sanctuary behind the curtain. We have this hope as an anchor. What anchors do you have in your life? This anchor, this hope is Jesus. And he is our rock, our firm foundation, the one that, if we want a parable in the Gospels, we read the story of the wise and the foolish builders, and they both built impressive looking homes, but only one stood the test, and that was the one who had a firm foundation. The ones that will stand the test are the ones who have the firm foundation or the anchor, and the anchor is Jesus. But over the next few weeks, I'm going to bring to you some tools, some things that I believe God has gifted us with that help us to carry the anchor of hope in Jesus around in our hearts in all circumstances at all times. Because I've been a sailor who has ever set out on the sea and said, I think we'll be okay without the anchor this time. They don't leave it on the shore. They don't look at the weather forecast and think, we're probably not going to need it. It's going to be okay. We'll just save a bit of weight. It'll help with the fuel economy. We're ecologically sensitive. And we'll just leave the anchor back as if he felt the weight of the thing. I've never met a sailor who's ever done that. They always have an anchor. Because you never know when the storm is going to come. You never know when those difficulties are going to be your experience. And you need to have it ready. Yes. And this morning, I want to look at communion. I want to look at the bread and the wine. I want to look at how communion, the Lord's Supper, is given to the body of Christ, to the church, to you and I as followers of Jesus, as a way of understanding and as a way of celebrating, way of knowing that there's an anchor within our soul that's continually part of our journey. And so we're going to look at this together today. I'm going to read a number of scriptures. I'm going to be pretty brief. I'm only going to preach about an hour today, so it's going to be much shorter than normal. And because I want to give some time at the end for us to celebrate exactly what we're going to look at today. I've got a lot of scriptures I'm going to bring you, and I'm going to try and not rush through them because the words are significant and they are powerful. The words of the Bible are more powerful than my words or my descriptions of them. But I'm aware that when you do that, it's quite possible to go into some form of spectator mode. Just read the words, particularly if they're familiar passages. And I want you to look with eyes of faith today in the scriptures. And I want you to see what's being said. And I want to give space for the word of God to live and to breathe in your soul today. So I'm not just going to parrot fashion read these through. I'm going to proclaim them to sink into your spirit and to let them shape you and change your life. Let's look at what the background of communion is, first of all. John's Gospel, chapter 6, verses 47 onwards, it says, "Very truly I tell you, the one who believes has eternal life. I am the bread of life." This is Jesus talking. "Your ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness." You remember that? When they were provided miraculously as they wandered in the wilderness. It says, "But yet they died. But here is the bread that comes down from heaven, which anyone may eat and not die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats this bread will live forever. This bread is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world." Then we look in Luke's Gospel 22. This is the moment where we might name it as the Last Supper. And Jesus, he took the bread, he gave thanks, and he broke it, and he gave it to them, saying, "This is my body for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Then in Matthew 26, verse 27, we read, he said these words, "Then he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, 'Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins.'" Here we've got some of the emblems we're going to be passing out a bit later on, wrapped in cellophane in order to keep it nice and soft and fresh. This, by the way, is not special bread that's been manufactured in a monastery somewhere and prayed over for 40 days. This is just available from your local supermarket. You tend not to buy it in small squares like that. Someone has come in diligently and they've chopped all the crust off and they've chopped it up into little bits. It's normal bread. It's not particularly significant whether it is this sort of bread or gluten-free bread or vegan bread or rice cakes or wafers or crackers. It doesn't really matter what it is. It's the power of what is represented here. We don't believe this bread becomes the actual body of Jesus. That's a theology known as transubstantiation. We don't believe this becomes the actual body of Jesus. But we do believe that the actual body of Jesus was given and broken in order for you a life-transforming, world-shaking truth that is available to you. And as you take this, you remember that and you encounter its power. I often try not to say we're going to pass the wine around now because I don't want someone who visits us to take a drink. That's not wine. Because I think we actually use cranberry juice. It doesn't really matter what it is. It's what it symbolizes. And this is the blood of Jesus being represented in this juice. And on this Last Supper moment, Jesus is gathered with his disciples and he breaks the bread And he's already spoken by himself being the bread of life, and he passes it around after giving thanks. And he says, I invite you now to partake of this bread of life, of my life that I'm giving for you. I'm pouring myself out. I'm going to shed my blood. I'm going to pour myself out for you. And I invite you. This is for you. And I invite you to partake of it. Now, slight digression. If I was to say now, let me change the context now. If I was to say to you, okay, we're going to take a few minutes break, and we're going to have a bit of a pub quiz together. Maybe we call it a church quiz, shall we? Rather make it a bit safer. We're going to have a church quiz together. And so what I would like you to do, I'd like you to get into pairs, and I would like you to answer the following questions. Now, you may be sat here thinking, oh, no, I'm terrible at general knowledge, and I really hope they don't ask anything about the Bible, because I'm going to be really struggling with answering the questions right now. I'm going to look really embarrassed. But then the person you pair up with, you discover, is the world's best general knowledge quiz person. How many of you know, because you're paired up with them, your inadequacies are less significant because you have someone with you who knows all the answers. You have someone with you that it doesn't matter about your inadequacies. You know that whatever you're asked, you're going to be able to put your hands up and say, we know the answer. We know the answer to that question. We know the answer. Yeah, we, our team. And you know, communion. So often I think the emphasis has been on a man examines his heart. That's absolutely what the scripture says. But it's almost like this is a reminder of how worm-like we are. They want to slither up to the communion table, aware of our weakness, aware of our failure, aware of our inadequacy, aware of our shame. And listen, no matter how bad you think you are, you're even worse than that. You know that? You know that? The Bible says, hearts, and you might think, oh, I'm actually a pretty good person. No, you just haven't found out the depths of what's in your heart yet. Because the Bible says that the heart is desperately wicked and deceitful above all things. You're not a sinner because you're sin. You sin because you're a sinner. You're born into this corruptness. You're not taught that. Kids don't get taught to do things wrong. They just know to do things wrong. It's instinctive within them. It's instinctive to be that rebellious person, that proud person. And so no matter how bad you think you are, you're worse than that. But this is not about reminding you of that worseness. This is not about you having a stick beat on you and said, what a terrible, inadequate, weak person you are. This is about you teaming up with Jesus, who has all the answers. And this is about you saying, we know the answers. We are free. We're full of life. We're full of hope. I have an anchor in my life, and his name is Jesus. And whatever you have, whatever failure you have, whatever shame you're carrying, Jesus has the answer to every single one of them. He is greater than those things. Forgiveness is a life-changing start, and communion is the celebration of the anchor of our souls. It's the promise of a covenantal commitment that God has with his people. You know what a covenant is? It's more than a promise. In fact, promises don't mean an awful lot in today's world, do they? It would seem that people can stand on stages in front of millions of viewers on TV and they can promise something that will happen in a nation. It seems like it gets forgotten once they get the votes, and it feels like promises are not worth that much these days. But I want you to know that God doesn't just make promises, he makes covenants. And God makes a covenant, and when he makes a covenant, he cannot get out of it. He cannot change. A covenant is a robust, fixed commitment that says this is an absolute, absolute, absolute promise. And he has invited you and I into a covenantal relationship. I mean, it's solid, it's strong. There's never going to be a moment where he turns his back and says, I've had enough of you. I fancy moving on to some other person now. He's committed. And communion is this wonderful, incredible, powerful, life-changing reminder and moment of understanding anew this commitment and this covenant. Maybe for years you've gone to church and you've taken communion and you've just had your bit of bread and your bit of juice and you've thanked God and he's forgiven your sins and you've moved on and it's become a religious exercise for you. It's become something of routine for you. But I want you to know that this is meant to have power. This is to be just the powers of the age to come breaking into your life and transforming your understanding of his covenant relationship with you. It's not meant to be something that you do out of routine. That's religion. It's meant to have life, have significance, have meaning. And maybe in a few moments' time, you're going to take the most significantly meant communion you've ever taken in your life. Maybe God's going to break into your soul. Maybe he's going to transform. Maybe he's going to open your blind eyes. Maybe he's going to deal with inadequacies you've carried for years. Because he has all the answers. And this is a celebration of the answers that he brings. So let me quickly look at some things that communion teaches us. First of all, communion is a moment where we resubmit to his ways. There's a synchronization that takes place. I've got my way, and he's got his way. And communion is a moment of getting off the conveyor belt of my way and saying, your ways are better. In fact, let me read some verses. Isaiah 55 says this, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, my thoughts higher than your thoughts." We have got some amazing minds in this room, but none of them are as good as the Lord's. We've got some people who live incredible ways and lifestyles in this room, but there's no one that's got the ways that can compete with the Lord's ways. And this is an opportunity to submit to his ways. Psalm 128 says, "Blessed is everyone who fears," another version says, "submits the Lord, who walks in his ways. You shall eat the fruit of the labor of your hands. You shall be blessed, and it shall be well with you." Knowing the blessing of the Lord upon your life is not about just in a service at some point putting your hand up and saying, "I want to give my life to Jesus," and just making a response there and then. Now that will maybe secure your eternal destiny if your heart is definitely crying out to the Lord. But to know the blessing of the Lord, you're to walk in his ways. And communion is that time when we take the bread and the wine, we say, "Thank you, Jesus, my answer, my redeemer, my hope, my king, the lover of my soul, the one who made covenant with me, I thank you." And I realize and surrender the pride of my heart to the ways of God. So we submit to his ways. Secondly, we remember his promises. I suffer from amnesia at times with the promises that God makes. I need to write them down. I need to be reminded of them. The scripture says, "Forget not all his benefits." You have a problem with forgetting. I know it. Sometimes you're jolly hard work on a Sunday. Am I allowed to say that? Some weeks you turn up and you are pumping with like, "God has just been so good. He's been so amazing." And you're walking in the fulfillment of all those wonderful things. And the next week, it's like trying to lead gravy in worship. You know, like you've forgotten. No, God hasn't changed. His ways haven't changed. His power hasn't changed. But you've forgotten. And we need to remind our souls. We're not the only ones. David, you know, the guy who wrote many of the Psalms, he had to speak to his own soul and say, "Bless the Lord, O my soul. All that is within me, bless his holy name." We need to deal with some spiritual amnesia in our lives. Forget not his benefits. We've got amazing people in the church. Every day, as a couple, they take communion together. And they remind themselves of the promises that God's spoken over their lives. As they partake in a reminder that the body and the blood of Jesus was shed for them, that all of his promises are yes, and what we sang earlier, that God is the one who completes. Psalm 145 says, "Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and your dominion endures through all generations. The Lord is trustworthy in all promises, and he is faithful in all that he does. Romans 4, verse 20 says this, yet he did not waver through unbelief regarding the promise of God, but was strengthened in his faith and gave glory to God, being fully persuaded that God had power to do that which he had promised. And we sit, we take communion, we partake in the body and the blood of Jesus, and we remember the promises of God that he will fulfill over our lives. Whether that feels like 10 years in the future, or 10 minutes, or whether it's something that you've been burdened with for 50 years and you've not seen the fulfillment, I guarantee you that the power of God has the ability and has made the commitment that he will fulfill all of his promises. And this is your reminder. So we submit to his ways, we remember his promises. Thirdly, we remember his faithfulness. Psalm 89 says, I will sing of the Lord's great love forever. With my mouth I will make your faithfulness known through all generations. If that wasn't a recruitment drive for getting involved in kids' work, I don't know what is. Telling of the faithfulness of God to all generations. I will declare that your love stands firm forever, that you established your faithfulness in heaven itself. He is unequivocally faithful. Even when we're faithless. Isaiah 25 says, O Lord, you are my God. I will exalt you and praise your name, for in perfect faithfulness. Perfect faithfulness. Whoa. That is an incredible statement. As if the word faithfulness wasn't enough. Perfect faithfulness. You have done wonderful things. Things planned long ago. We submit to his ways, we remember his promises, we remember his faithfulness. And then we remember his unbreakable covenant. An unbreakable covenant. 1 Thessalonians 5, 24 says this, he who calls you is faithful, and listen to this, and he is committed to do it. Committed. That is an active term. That's not a description of an aspiration. That has intentionality and action. He is committed to do it. Everything that he has promised, he is faithful and will do it. Hebrews 9:15 says this, for this reason, Christ is the mediator of a new covenant, that those who are called may receive the promised eternal inheritance, now that he has died as a ransom to set them free from the sins committed under the first covenant. This is not just an idea. This is not just a nice relationship. This is not just something that God's trying to go on a moralistic campaign to make society better in some way. This is an absolute ironclad commitment, a covenant that you are his people. I will be their God and you will be my people. God is absolutely committed to you. And you can run away from him. You can stick your fingers up at him. You can swear at him. You can try and run to the ends of the earth, and he is committed to you. Right. He will chase you. Right. He won't let you go. You're watching online, and maybe there's something you're running away from the Lord on, something you've known his love, but you're running away, and God is chasing after you. Right. You've even switched Facebook on this morning, thinking you can just have some brainless, senseless sort of updates on a feed, but somehow you've come across church, and God is chasing you. And he wants you to know his love. Maybe you've been dragged here this morning by a friend or a family member. And you know there are some experiences that have happened in your life that identify God is real, but you've hidden that because dealing with it is too painful. But I want you to know that you've got a comforter and a friend, and you've got a lover of your soul that's committed to giving you his love and inviting you into a relationship with him. Wow. That relationship, as we take the bread, is it that strong? But I've had a bad week. Surely that changes things. No, it changes nothing. I saw a Christian the other day on one of the social media outlets. They reflecting on the apparent chaos in the politics in our nation. He said, I'm struggling to think of anything good right now. What? I can't think of any. There's nothing good. Can someone help me understand something good? What? You mean you've forgotten about the biggest miracle the world has ever seen? You've forgotten that your soul has been transformed by the sacrifice of the Son of God who came to this earth to find you and to give his life as a ransom for you? Have you forgotten? I think he had. See, we all suffer from amnesia. But he never forgets. He'll never forget you. He'll never let you go. I love that song. There's no mountain he won't climb up. Shadow he won't light up. Coming after me. Wall he won't kick down. Lie he won't tear down. Coming after you. Because he's committed. So we submit to his ways. We remember his promises. We remember his faithfulness. We remember his unbreakable covenant. And then we receive and give his love. Romans 8 says nothing, can't say that word any stronger, nothing will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Nothing. 1 Corinthians 11, so then whoever eats the bread, ooh, this is a painful one. So then, whoever eats the bread, Mark, what are you doing? Because you've been encouraging us to now, and this looks like a really heavy verse. Mark, what are you doing? 1 Corinthians 11 says this. So then, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner, because see, this is a deeply powerful spiritual thing. And you can do it in an unworthy manner, it says. That you will be guilty of sinning against the body and the blood of the Lord. So if you eat this in an unworthy manner, you're going to be guilty of something against God. Whew. Now, I've met people that have refused to take communion for 30 years because of some issue in their heart or in their life from their past that they disqualifies them. Well, have a guess what? Everyone's a tow rag that comes to the table. Everybody is a ragamuffin that comes to the table. Everybody is in need of a partner that makes up for our inadequacies with his answers. And so that's not what unworthiness is. But if you go back prior to these few verses, it talks about how there were some things taking place in the early church where people were gathering together and they were taking communion in separate little groups. And it wasn't just for administrative purposes. It was because they had elements of arrogance in their heart about themselves compared to other people. It was because they were looking after their own interests, not the interests of others. It was because they had some fallout. It was because they had some cliques and they had some division among them. And that is what Paul's addressing here. You see, we have one Father. We are one family. We have one Savior. We have one baptism. We have one Redeemer of our souls. We have one Savior of the world. And we take one communion as one family. Unity is important to God. As freely as you've received, freely give. So, God, I receive your unconditional, beautiful, powerful love in my life, but I'm not going to pass it on to them. You take it in an unworthy manner. Because you don't believe it. Because if you believed it, it'd flow out of you. Ephesians 5. Follow God's example, therefore, and live a life of love, just as Christ loved us and gave himself for us as a fragrant offering and a sacrifice to God. We submit to his ways, we remember his promises, we remember his faithfulness, we remember his unbreakable covenant, and we receive and give his love. And finally, we share in his victory. Ephesians 2, verse 6. This is talking about you. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus. When you gave your life to Christ, he elevated you. He took off your filthy rags of your best attempts and your own righteousness, and he places his pure, spotless robe of righteousness around you, and he gives you a seat in the heavenly places. That means we're not on earth trying to just shout and get the attention of a passing God. We are sitting in a place clothed in righteousness, in royal robes, with the attention of the Almighty God and his power present with us. Bible says we are temples of the Holy Spirit. He resides within us. And you don't know how much power you have in you. You don't know. And I tell you, if you did, you'd probably pray more. Try every other option first. And the power of eternity resides in the people of God. When we pray with authority. More on that on another week. Matthew 16, 19 says, I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. The authority that the people of God have. Revelation 12, 11 finally says, they triumphed over the enemy by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. They did not love their lives so much as to shrink from death. That the power of the blood of Jesus has set us free, that we are able to approach his throne boldly, confidently. The power of God resides in the people of God. Yeah, but Mark, you don't understand. What about Brexit? Mark, you don't understand. I've just lost my job. Mark, you don't understand. My wife's just left me. Mark, you don't understand. I'm not able to pay the mortgage this month. I'm not professing to understand the circumstances and the pain of everyone in this room. But I do know this. He who is with you and who is in you is greater. And if you want an anchor, you need a reminder. As often as they met, they would take communion because they didn't want to forget. We're going to play a track of music that just simply says, I am held. And as we play this music, our stewards are going to serve the bread and the juice. Don't take this as a religious exercise, but open your heart to a covenantal God who is with you. If you don't know Jesus as your Savior, then as this is being led, I'd love you to come to the front, to stand on the front somewhere. One of our team will come and they'll talk with you and they'll pray with you. They'll give you some information that will help, because we would love you to celebrate your first Jesus-soaked communion this morning. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your body and your blood given so freely for us. And now, as we feast upon the bread of life. As we are reminded of the power of the blood of the Lamb which overcame the power of Satan, I pray that eyes will open. I pray that hearts will be expanded. I pray that shame will be gone. Bondage will be broken. And your life-changing power will be released. So we thank you for the body and the blood of Jesus.
My heart is attached.
His covenantal love upon you. Just love the mercy and the grace of the Lord that's so freely poured over us, awakens us to that love. If you're wanting to take this moment to renew a commitment to the Lord, to renew a walk with Him, to renew your heart to synchronize with His, and I'm particularly going to ask those who are saying, I want my heart to be revived, I don't want to go through just the mechanics of church and Christianity. I want my heart to be alive. I'm going to ask that you stand where you are. I'm going to ask that you stand as part of that expression of synchronization with God. Your response, I re-surrender my heart. Will you just stand now where you are? That's your heart. That place of renewal. It's a renewal of our understanding of who He is, and it's a renewal of our commitment to Him. It's a renewal of our desire to follow Him. Renewal of our expression of our need of Him. And there are more lives I know here that your heart is responding with a yes to God. Stand and join us if that's you. This is not an admission of big sin in your life, it's just a renewal of your vow with Him. Given their life to Jesus. I know I said about coming forward, no one's done that, but I don't want to miss the opportunity. If anyone has not received Jesus as their Savior, the Bible says if you believe with the Lord Jesus Christ, confess Him with your mouth, you shall be saved. Believe in your heart, confess with your mouth. Is there anyone who wants to give their life to Jesus today, respond to His love, His mercy and His grace? If so, will you just lift your hands where you are? When I've seen your hand, I'll just know to include you in a prayer. Our team would love to come and bring something and place it in your hand. If you're online, you can click a banner on the screen and let us know you've prayed that prayer. Is there anyone? Father, revive our hearts. Come on, who wants a revival in their heart? Who wants to know that freshness? The walk with the Lord. Come on, I don't want to live in a place tired with religion, tired with church, and just accepting the norms of routine. I don't want to have a form of godliness without power. I want the power and the presence of God to be at work in my life, to be at work in our community. I want a church to be anchor ready. Are you anchor ready? Anchor ready? Do you know the Spirit of the Lord resides in you? Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Father, I pray that you'll reveal and release and pour out a revival heart upon your people, I pray. God, that we'll be captivated for the things of eternity, for the things of your kingdom. God, that we would come alive with the reality and the presence and the power and the life of God. Come alive with the healing purposes of God. Come alive with the prophetic nature of God. That we would come alive, oh God, to the work of your Spirit. But come alive. Come alive, oh church. Come alive. Come alive to God's call upon you. Come alive to his destiny in your life. Come alive, all those dreams that are within your heart. Come alive, all those things that the Lord has promised over your life. Come alive, oh church. Wake up, oh church. Wake up, oh sleeper. Come alive.